far from me.
All right. Welcome, everybody, to We Are Back. We're back.
Wrong movie. You were gone.
We are back from our hiatus. My hiatus. I was on vacation. So, and obviously, if you are just tuning in, we are going to discuss one of my favorite TV shows of all time, Firefly. And I want to welcome Bruce and Kent once again to joining us into this special episode. And of course, Mary Beth.
Hi, guys.
So, yeah. Let me get ours up so I can see who is, if anybody.
Yeah, I'm gonna pull up our comments so I can see those. You might hear it for a second, but I'll mute it.
Yeah. We are back. Oops, there's us. I never get this right. I don't know why.
I know. You put it on, then you have to mute it really quick.
Hey, Roy.
Hi, Roy. We have Roy. Who else is watching? Anybody?
I don't know. Let me get, we'll do our drink. Of course, we have to have something from Firefly. And as soon as I get it up here, I will share it. Why isn't it coming up? Where is my drink? Hello. Oh, my computer's acting up for some reason. I can't. I'm not still sharing, right? No.
Nope.
Oh, well, we'll get it up when I get it up. But it's Mutter's Milk, of course.
Of course. So cheers.
Easy, Kent. I see that.
I'm sorry.
This is a family show. No, it's not. Wow, we're a little off today, aren't we? So anyway, all right, Firefly.
Great comeback, guys.
So, aired on Fox in 2002 on a Friday night, I believe at 8 or 9 o'clock p.m. I was sitting there watching it. Loved it from the get-go, even though they were shown out of order. They showed the train job first. And Fox killed it after, what, 10 episodes, I think, for whatever reason. They claimed it wasn't getting the ratings, but you put it on Friday at 8 or 9 o'clock, what do they expect? I mean, people are out watching. So, guys, what are your thoughts on the show? It's not just me talking.
I thought it was groundbreaking. I love the universe building that took place. The fact that, there's a game. It's a card game, basically. But it boils D&D down to the bare essentials. You kick in the dungeon door and...
Drink. Keep talking.
There's Mutter's Milk, yeah. So you kick in the door and you either loot the room or fight the monster. It boils it right down to the essentials.
Make it sound like one of those video games.
I know, right? So they came out with a space expansion. So it's lasers and ships and that stuff. And then they came out with a cowboy and Indian expansion. And if you shuffle those two decks together, you can play a game of Firefly.
Play Firefly.
Smartest thing I've ever
seen. It is a space western. I'm going to take this down. It's on our website if anybody wants to copy it down. It is a space western. There's no question about it. Joss has Whedon, who is the director and producer, has put these two universes, basically the Old West and space, into one show. And one would think, well, how's that work? But it does work. And the way they got it to work is because we as humans have gone out into the, found a new solar system and terraformed all these planets. And some planets were a little bit more rural and agrarian than the central planets, as they put it, which were more modern and cities. So you have horses and cows and people growing crops and with basic technology. And then you have planets that are very technologically advanced. And I think that's where the war came, when they have the Alliance, who are the modern worlds, and you have the Independents, who are the outer planets and moons, tried to break away and they lost miserably.
Not a lot of resources, and they got outproduced by the inner planets.
Yep. And so that's where we kind of find a few years about 5 or 10 years after the war is when we first meet our characters. Mal was a sergeant in the brown coats, the Independents called themselves, because they used to wear brown coats. And, we find the
long dusters.
Right. And it's in the original pilot episode, we find him in a bar on Unification Day, which was the day that they gave up, basically, and signed and basically the armistice and gave up. And of course, Zoe, who is his first mate, always seems, how do we always find ourselves in a Alliance bar on Unification because he always wants to pick a fight with somebody. So, yeah. You know, and it's fighting ensues. So,
hey, Fez is on.
Yeah, so many great. That's what I think is so. One of the things that's so great about the show is that how well fleshed out the universe is, and it's only a solar system, folks. There is no light faster than light speed.
Yeah, there's not zipping between galaxies
in the solar system that has more planets and more moons than ours does, and they've terraformed. So that's why it seems like you're going to all these different planets, but in fact, they are all within the same solar system. So they can.
If I remember from the role playing game, which is Joss Whedon approved. There's 50 habitable either moons or planets in the whole system. Right. Some of the planets orbit big gas giants like the moon of Yavin in Star Wars. Some of them like Jupiter, the rock that have been terraformed. But yeah, 50 different places you can visit.
Yeah. So, you know, so there's certainly a vast universe. We have several bad guys. We have, of course, the Alliance is the general evil empire bad guy. Fascists. Of course, there's a lot of stuff going on with them. And then we have these kind of, we don't know what they are in the TV series called the Reavers, which are kind of these savage, crazy, are they men? Are they aliens? They don't really explain what they are.
They're a primal
I think Jewel had said, it's like they said that they're just men that went out to the edge of the black, as they call it, and went all bibbly over it, as she put it.
Yeah, it was Zoe who was like, with the Reavers, like, they'll rape you to death and then sew your skin to them and hopefully kill you in that order.
So they're very brutal. But we do learn what happens to them. We'll get to it later.
You get introduced to them, but then you don't get a whole lot of them throughout the run of the series.
No, they're kind of pocketed in there here and there.
Not until Serenity. Then the Serenity,
of course, because they're, as again, not to get ahead of ourselves, they become a key focal point of that story.
Yeah, he used them very sparingly in season one. Season two was going to have more encounters lead up to Serenity.
Okay. So I want to hear, Bruce and Ken, I want to hear what it is about the show that draws you in. Remember, and what I like about it was actually Joss's pitch. His pitch for this show was, it's the story of nine people staring into the black of space and each one sees something different.
Yep, that makes a lot of sense to me. The thing I like best about it was the universe building. It seemed like such a complete thing. Star Trek suffers from this a little bit. Star Wars suffers from it a lot. There's a forest planet and there's nothing on this thing but forest. Or there's an ice planet and there's nothing on this thing but ice. It's like, that's not how things should work. A normal planet is going to have different zones, temperate zones and Arctic and deserts and whatever else. Yeah. They weren't complete worlds. Each of the whole solar system thing just held together really well. You're going to have developed cities. You're going to have guys living on the edge. You're going to have a cow is a wonderful mechanism for turning grass into food
and fuel.
You turn it loose in a field, not a lot of maintenance. You come back and you pick up the food later. That kind of basic.
What are we eating exactly?
Well, yeah, yeah. Really. What are you eating, Kit? That you're picking up the food.
What are we picking up and eating?
I got my dinner here, which includes beef, actually.
Cow pie. Cow pie.
Cow pies. Yeah. Well. So, if you're going to have a fringe, they're going to be subsistence farmers. They're not going to have all the latest technology. They're not going to have hover cars and laser guns and all the stuff we see in the inner cities, the big cities on the various planets. What they're gonna have is the bare minimum, and there are some high tech stuff here and there.
There was a mix though, even on some of the backwards worlds where you'll see something with like 11.
Yeah, like when they threw Mal through the glass window of the bar.
Yeah,
and it wasn't a glass window. It was
right. It got thrown through the thing. It was like a force field. It really wasn't a real glass window. It's a great example. So you would see this mix of technology and old stuff. And you know, the other thing that he did, which I think is so great, is that he mixed the human race.
Absolutely.
You know, we have a language that sounds very Western to us, at least very country. And then they'll go in and they'll curse in Chinese.
Yep.
Which makes sense because the Asian population is so huge that if we were all going to start merging together, which we're starting to see that now in our lifetime, where we have traveled so quickly between continents that we are merging. And
they didn't, you know,
the cultures kind of began to mesh into
that,
one.
That was one criticism that I picked up from some friends, and I've since gone back and rewatched it and picked up the same vibe. They didn't have enough Asian people in the backgrounds or in.
I would agree with that. Characters. They could have done more with that. More of a Blade Runner.
Was actually supposed to be played by an Asian actress. She was actually written initially as Asian.
Right, and then they ended up with the incredible Summer Glau, which.
Jewel.
Kaylee. I'm sorry. I thought I remember reading that River Tam was supposed to be Asian.
Well, then they would have had to make the brother theoretically.
Right. Which again, I thought was the plan, but.
And it would have worked. I mean, again, if we want to talk about cast, can you imagine anybody else playing these characters? I mean, now that we've known them, we've. No. I mean, again. I say this so many times, lightning in a bottle, but this show has so many things that just come together.
Yep. As a matter of fact, when I watched the new V with Marina Bacar, I couldn't take her character. I couldn't.
But she's awesome in Deadpool.
Oh yeah. But that's still a variety too. Of.
I didn't see V, so I can't.
She killed that guy. She was good in V. Yeah.
She was good, but I couldn't get past. Inara. And when you look at it, Deadpool's girlfriend is a variant of Inara when you boil
it. Oh, well, really, I would say it's a pretty wide parallel there. Can't, other than the fact that they were both prostitutes.
Exactly.
That was probably the only parallel.
Motherly, both kind of motherly. She was like the ship's mother, sort of.
Yeah.
In a way.
Yeah. She was she is a geisha, not a necessarily a prostitute.
Well, she's for hire, we'll call it. And
right, but a geisha is a geisha is for hire too, and not necessarily for sex. They provide music, they provide entertainment, they provide.
Yeah, she was a companion, I believe, is what they
right.
You know,
but
and let's call, you know.
But
all know what she did. Which is why Mal kept calling her a whore, which drove her crazy, because they had this secret love affair with each other. And, you know, he would always throw out the word whore on her, and she would always get very upset with him. But, you know, he did it probably just as a kind of a way to.
And she'd come back with petty thief. I mean,
right.
You know,
right.
I disagree with you, Kent. I don't think that the world building, that certainly didn't grab me to begin with. I just thought somebody had shuffled the deck together and sort of as Mike says, you know, okay, I've got this Western role-playing and I've got this space and I'll just shuffle them together. What really drew me in were the characters. And I mean, that's a Joss Whedon thing is he made these characters so three-dimensional and so nuanced and stuff like that.
Right, but the world building is what gives them that depth. There was a revolution that failed.
I don't know if it's so much world building as that it's backstory.
Yeah.
You know, okay. I mean, we had to know, and that's why in the pilot episode we start with Mal in the Battle of Serenity Valley, which is what the ship is named after.
Right.
I mean, we see him and what he does, and you know, one of the greatest lines is, you know, it's like, you know why we're not going to die? Because we're too damn pretty. God just won't let us die because we're too, you know. That kind of dialogue is what makes the show great. I mean, it has so many one-liners in this whole show and the film.
Oh yeah,
that I use almost daily. You know,
but to me, the combination of the characters, the backstory, and as you're saying, the cast. I mean, look at the you know.
Oh yeah,
pretty much every member of the cast has gone on to do something else, you know, and do it successfully.
Mm-hmm.
You know. Sean Mayer, I think, is the only one who really didn't go on to anything.
Yeah, I think they all, because Jewel went on to do Stargate.
Atlantis.
And she's done other things, of course. Summer Glaude did the Fox version of Terminator.
Yep.
Nathan has done everything. Did a couple shows, Castle, and I think he's on a new show, The Rookie or something.
Yeah.
You know, obviously we just talked about Marina. Ron Glass, of course, had already a career at that. You know, Marty Miller. Who remembers Marty Miller? You know, I do. My dad used to watch that religiously. So you know, and then you know,
and
he's done so much voiceover work and other things. He's just out there. Of course, if you want to see something really great that Nathan and him did was they did a web show.
Con Men.
I was going to say Comic Men, but yeah, Con Men, which is basically kind of based on. It's almost like a Shatner kind of a thing where you have they were on this great sci-fi show and now it's gone and Nathan was the main character and his career is taking off and poor Alan is not doing well and it's funny.
He plays an inspired bad guy.
My wife and I loved Castle, and I mean, the amount of times he riffed on Firefly during that show was...
Yeah, there's a lot of... And you know, here's something interesting. My daughter watched Castle on Netflix or whatever, didn't know anything about Firefly. I know, my fault. And I said, well, you know, I said, he was my captain before he was your Castle. And she's like, what? And I said, did you hear it? And I showed her Firefly, and she fell in love with Firefly.
You beast, you made her watch all 13 episodes and then stopped.
Yeah, well, no, I warned her. I warned everybody. I warned, if you have not seen this, and anybody who's listening, if you have not seen Firefly and you don't, you're like, what are these guys talking about? It is only 13 episodes and a movie. Thank God for Joss for giving us the movie.
And you will be emotionally shattered.
So just prepare yourself when you're at episode 13. You're like, how is there no more of this?
Yeah. Once you're emotionally crushed.
Because the last episode is one of the best ones with Jubal Early.
Mm-hmm. He's one of
my favorite characters. Every time I see that actor, I just said, does that sound right to you? I still use that. I'll go, does that sound right to you?
So is he an operative or a failed operative?
No, he's a bounty hunter.
Right. But I'm saying that proto character... to me calls back.
He wasn't smart enough.
I can't say his name.
No, he's to me, he was more the Boba Fett of the Firefly universe.
Right. But I see him as like a reject from the operative program or a failed operative that
I don't. Yeah. Very failed because he clearly had, he had issues. I mean, the guy was crazy.
Not that the operative didn't, but
the operative, I don't think was crazy. He was just,
He was a
believer. He was a fanatic. He believed in what he was doing and to no end. And there was nothing that he would not do to complete.
To make things right. Yeah.
The greater good.
Yeah. So, and he ended up, of course, at the end, Kent, you muted yourself again.
No, I didn't. This thing is just.
Come back, Kent.
There's Kent. He's back.
I swear, if I touch my keyboard.
Come back to the light, Kent.
Light. How's that?
We're talking about the operative is in the film. Okay, so people that don't know, we're talking about the operative is in the film, and he's the bad guy that's chasing them in the film. Who is played by somebody? Remind me the actor. The actor's great.
The actor's amazing. He's won a BAFTA and he's Oscar nominated. All the time, he's something. I'll look him up.
He is so good in that role.
He was chilling.
Yes.
He was awesome.
Yes.
When he's talking to Kaylee about what could happen.
I just love the scene where he's got the sword. Again, we're getting ahead of each other, but he's holding the sword down and he's got the guy that the scientist has been
paralyzed. About...
And the guy's falling forward and he can't stop himself because he's paralyzed. He's just holding the sword in front of him. Saying,
oh, no, I'm talking about Jubal Early.
You're talking about Jubal. No, I'm talking about the operative. The operative.
Yeah.
He never did get his name.
Right. Chiwetel?
Yes, Jubal Early also was an excellent guy.
That's the one, when he's describing what he's going to do to Kaylee, I was incredibly chilling.
Yeah. He was such a good character.
He's going to be in Doctor Strange.
Who? Now, which guy?
Chadweedle, the operative.
The operative?
Yeah.
Yeah, he was in...
He's around. He's done a bunch.
He was in... Was it The Martian? He was like a ground...
Children of Men. Yes. He was in Children of Men.
Yeah, and he was in The Martian.
Yeah, he was like one of the ground control guys. Like,
yeah, he was the two steps down in NASA. He was head of the Ares program, but not head of NASA.
And most importantly, he was in Sherlock Gnomes.
Oh,
it was classic. Completely different people here. Oh no, he was in. Okay, wait.
He's in the Old Guard with Charlize
Theron. Yeah, Sherlock Gnomes, The Martian. Yeah. You're right. I can't read.
The Old Guard was great, by the way. If anybody hasn't seen that,
Sue's saying it says 14 episodes. That's because there's a two-parter. So we consider it. It was actually
I'm answering.
It was supposed to be a two-hour one, so that I consider that one episode. So. Because I believe if you get the DVD, it plays it as 1 2-hour episode.
Steve, correct. Steven Schmidt is saying, am I a lion? I don't think of myself as a lion. I do have a mighty roar. No, I meant a lion. Oh, I heard lion.
Yeah.
Captain Phil's here. He says, I never watched the last couple episodes. I was saving them since it will probably never come back.
They're the best ones.
I know. They're some of the best ones, the last couple.
Phil Merkel. Phil's,
I'm a leaf on the wind.
I'm a leaf on the wind. How do Reavers? Okay, how do Reavers clean their spears? They run them through the wash.
If you haven't seen the film, that's a spoiler.
Spoiler.
Yeah, I just like, I'm a leaf on the wind. What's that mean? I don't know.
I think we can take a nanosecond here to say happy birthday to Phil.
Oh yes, hey, happy birthday, big happy birthday to Phil, birthday Captain to Phil. It's his birthday today. So.
Yeah, mine's thank coming you for up. Joining
I forgot
us.
My I forgot my drink. I feel like I'm no wonder I'm like, where is my
you got your pistol though. That's all that matters.
I do.
Yeah, everyone who is armed, we're safe because everyone's armed.
We're not allowed weapons north of the border, you know.
You're certainly not like these.
And then of course, you know, I have so much Firefly stuff. This is like, and if you can't see, like this whole row, all these little figurines are all the characters from the show.
Nice.
So yeah, I just absolutely, I even have somewhere around here Wash's dinosaur set.
Do sweet. You?
Yeah.
Curse your son.
You'll call it this land. Curse your inevitable display.
You can't curse your expected but inevitable. Yeah.
And the fact that he's supposed to be monitoring things and he's got them scattered all over
the screen.
You just have to throw them off to see what's going on.
Yeah, Wash is probably one of my favorite characters.
One of my favorites.
Yeah, no, he always
the Wash Zoe combo.
Yes, because you don't. Because again, and even they play on that you'd never put those two together. You know, you have this Amazon warrior type woman.
Oh, sorry.
Strong, and then you've got Wash, who's kind of this sort of meek, you know, piloty guy. You know, he's just.
This wonderful replica that I'm holding is courtesy of my son Steven, who is in on the chat and just made a point of saying, no what? No shout out for the guy who got you the gun. Thank you, Steven.
Oh, you know who I bought my own.
You gun. Bought your own, yes.
We were talking before the show started. All the weapons were real weapons.
Yep.
Modified a built bit off to of TV, a
but... pistol.
We were discussing that again. It goes back to that mixture of technology because you see some of the Alliance have laser guns and, you know, ray guns or whatever you want to call them. And then, you know, again on the backward worlds, and even most of the people are using regular firearms. They look a little science fiction-y, but they're firearms nonetheless. There is the one episode where they try to steal the very first laser pistol that humans ever produced called the Lassiter, which is worth a lot of money. And I thought that was, I don't know why I thought that was such a cool name to name a gun. It was the Lassiter. No, it sounds Western, doesn't it?
Just yep. Well, it like this Lasso, is a, I guess. This you know. Is a Moses. Oh goodness. I've forgotten the name now.
Which one is that? Is it the Mouse?
Yeah
I can tell you what that is.
It's called a Moses something. That's a biblical name, by the way.
Really?
Good thing we have Kent here to absolutely. Keep us up on our biblical references.
What would
the Moses Brothers self-defense engine Frontier Model B.
Yes. Self-defense engine. I like that
self-defense engine, which, what is there of an engine in a gun?
Well, in the meaning that it's a mechanism. It's an engine of destruction.
Oh, an engine of destruction. Ah.
Or self-defense, as the case may be.
Right.
But going back to Wash and Zoe, has anyone ever met Gina Torres in real life?
No, I wish I have.
She just has a presence.
I can imagine. She has a presence on screen.
In my opinion, she tones it down for the screen.
Really?
Oh yeah. I mean, she walks into a room and you know, it's not a sexual thing or something, but she just has this presence about her. It's amazing.
They genuinely enjoy each other, Alan and Gina. I was watching them to prepare for this. I was watching Comic-Con, like old Comic-Con, and they tell this funny story about having a bed scene. And Alan's like, so it's freezing on set, right? It's cold. So Alan's like, there I am in my space pajamas. And he's like, and there's the bed. So I jump in the bed. And then Gina walks in and sees him already in the bed. She's like, oh, damn. But then she climbs in anyway. And they both sit there quietly. And then she's like, well, get over here. So he goes to snuggle with her. I think they genuinely adored each other. And the crew was like, you guys want to, like, you know, get off the set for a second? They're like, no, no, we're fine. We're good. We're just going to snuggle.
Yeah, she's married to Lawrence Fishburne. I don't know if I'd rub that rhubarb.
Kent, the Moses engine is actually in real life a Taurus Model 85 revolver.
Yep. You can see the outline of it. This is a shroud extended, that they dropped over.
Yeah.
This is the actual pistol. And this is the actual pistol starting. And then this little guy right here is covering the cylinder. It's a six shooter. But this covers that cylinder, so you won't see it rotate or anything when he fires it. The regular hammer back here, and then this is all tchotchkes to hide the revolver, and then the barrel comes out like so.
James, Vera, well, whatever he had. James was a Lamat revolver.
Yep, and then Jane had that awesome,
Vera.
Yes.
Vera.
Zoe's was a Colt 1860 Army.
Yeah, she had basically what was called a mare's leg. It was very short. In fact, we saw that. If you ever saw the Western that Steve McQueen was in, somebody help me out. It's what he used to have. It's a short, very short, very short.
Lever action
rifle. In fact, I have one upstairs, a real one, in my real arsenal. New Hampshire, live free or die. Anyway. Anyway, so what else will we talk about for this show? I mean, there's just so many things. I'm like, I want to keep going in different directions. We can talk about the film. Of course, we ran the episodes several years later. The show hit big in, you know, after the show aired, the fandom was huge. Clearly enough that Joss felt he had to go pitch to Universal to make the film. The film really was made for the fans. They pretty much were aware that it wasn't going to be a huge financial success. They knew that going in, but because it was just the fans of Firefly that were probably going to come out, although I'm sure a lot of people went and saw it beyond that. So they wrapped up the story of, which is basically, we have these, if you haven't figured it out already, you have this freighter, with a captain and his crew, and he has a few passengers, and one of the passengers appears to be nuts with her brother, and they're on the run from the Alliance because the Alliance wants her back because she has knowledge in her head that they don't want people to find out. And in the film we find out what that was. Now I don't want to do we want to do spoilers
what that was?
Yeah, well, I think that was, they implied in the film that one big secret she was carrying was what was making her loopy. Cause pretty much she's like, they go, are you okay? And she's like, yeah, like,
right. I'm, and she ends okay up flying now. Serenity.
Yeah. And she ends up being like, I'm okay now. Like, yeah, I'm not nuts anymore. Cause I was able to get this off my chest, so to speak.
Let's go with as nuts.
As nuts.
Right. Well, she's, you know, still hiding in the ceiling, watching Kaylee and,
well, she's still a teenager and she's still a little odd. There's no question about it, but she's not going to have these weird where she freaks out and starts shooting people. And at least we hope not.
Right.
One of the things that supposedly cemented the deal with for the film was the fact that the DVDs sold out from this of the series in 24 hours.
Yep. They really? Had to make multiple reprintings.
Yeah. And that kind of response went, okay.
Yeah, I have several copies because, you know, I had to buy a DVD and then it came out on Blu-ray. And there's like, man. It's...
Then you lend it to a friend and then they take off with it and you got to get another set.
You got to have it on Blu-ray.
That happened to me at least once.
The River character, we were talking to Dr. Phil the other day and I described her as a berserker. Of course, I maybe had Serenity, and was thinking of Serenity at the moment, but she's more of a Jean Grey. Would she describe the River character?
She's got Jane convinced that she can kill him with her mind.
Yeah, she also, but that doesn't I mean, kill you with my that, mind. Yeah.
And she probably can because she certainly has some kind of, she can read people's minds.
They establish her as psychic. Yeah. And she shoots with her eyes closed in that one.
Yeah, I mean, they took her a very gifted child, is basically how they described her, and the Alliance messed with her brain and turned her into a weapon.
Yeah.
But in that process, she learned how to kill efficiently, but she also went a little crazy. And then she picked up some knowledge that she wasn't supposed to have. That was pretty big stuff as far as the universe was concerned. And,
I got to go with the operative on this one. Why on earth would you bring high level Alliance politicians into a room
With a psychic.
It's colossally stupid.
Yeah, well, it is. And you know, obviously they didn't think.
What didn't really get in that thing was, what was she beforehand? Was it the experiments that made her psychic? Was it the experiments that just turned her into the weapon and she was a psychic already? You knew she was gifted. That's why she went to this academy. But, you know, you're not quite sure if they were just taking bright kids and
My take on it, because I don't think they ever explained specifically, is that she was at this level and then they messed with her brain and actually enhanced a lot of her abilities. So I think they psychic before they screwed around with her brain.
When they did the analysis on Angel, or Haven, I forget the name of the place where they faked the hospital transport and got into the hospital.
It was Persephone.
When they analyzed that scan, I thought Simon was pretty convinced that they had shut off the part of her brain that regulates pain and something else.
Emotion, maybe.
Right.
Emotion,
they definitely rewired her brain and not necessarily in a good way. So that's another reason I think he was able to help her, because from that point on, he was able to, she got a little bit better because he knew how to treat her.
Right.
But I think the final straw was for her, at least not being completely always freaking out, was that revelation when she discovered that one. And I don't know if we want to give it up or not to people on the movie. I feel like a lot of people hadn't seen it and they're like going to give them spoilers.
15 years since the movie, almost 20 years since the show. I think the spoiler period. Safe.
Yeah, you're right. So basically we find out that inadvertently, the Alliance created the Reavers. They set up a colony, a planet. They terraformed it, and they put something in the air handlers to calm people down, to basically remove aggression. And it worked on 90% of the population, or 99% of the population, but 1% of the population had the absolute opposite effect, and it sent them absolutely crazy, and they became the Reavers. And the Reavers basically lived in space, in derelict spaceships that they cobbled together around this planet. They didn't live on the planet. They just lived around it for some reason. And through the course of the film, the crew of Serenity find out about this planet. They go there. They find a crashed Alliance ship.
Oh, Steven's right. It was Ariel, not Persephone.
Yeah. Oh.
Ariel. Yeah.
It was Ariel. Okay.
Yeah, sorry.
Okay. They got a lot of planets.
They do, 50 of them.
So they go to this planet, which is named Miranda, and they find this crashed Alliance ship, and they find a record, and they find out basically that this woman, who was the captain, I assume, of the ship, is giving this report saying, you know, we created the Reavers and da-da-da. And
yeah, the number of the ship was amazing. The C-57D.
Yeah, it was C-57D.
Which is the ship
in there. Those
Forbidden Planet.
Forbidden Planet. There's always a bunch of Easter eggs in the show. There's a Han frozen in carbonite in the dining area on a little wall, a little tiny thing. There's all kinds of little things in the show if you know to look for them. But so basically they find this record and they need to get it out to the rest of the universe to find out show that the Alliance did this. And the reason is, his thinking is, you know, right now they know it was a mistake, but eventually they'll come back to the reason.
They'll get it right.
They can fix people. And so they get it ultimately through a course of events. They are able to broadcast this signal and everybody in the whole universe
can't stop the signal.
Can't stop the signal. Knows now that the Alliance inadvertently created the Reavers by trying to control a population. And now you know the whole plot of the movie.
Sorry.
Yeah. Mal's character thing was that he just didn't like people meddling.
Right. Exactly. And that's something that Summer River says. In when they flash back to when she's in school and she's like, and they're talking about the war with the Alliance why did they break away? And she's like, because we meddle and people don't like to be meddled with. They don't like to be told what to do. And hell, we know that's true. I mean, so again, there was that common theme. We kind of see kind of a precursor to what was going to actually happen.
Right in the beginning of the series, though, we do meet a Reaver. I believe we actually see him become a Reaver, and I'm kind of
right.
Memory is failing me.
They come across the episode was you're gonna make me. I can't think of it. I have to go back.
Early.
Yeah.
Was it Bushwhack? No.
But the way he became a Reaver wasn't quite exactly the way Serenity described it.
Well, it was in the fact that the Reavers took the guy and then tortured and killed the rest of his crew in front of him and drove him over the edge.
Right. He became a kind of a Reaver because he watched their horrific acts.
I guess I was really thinking of the gas had more effect than just watching someone be tortured. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Bushwhack. It was Bushwhack.
Was it Bushwhack? Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And basically they come across this derelict colony ship and they realize that once they get on board that Reavers had been there. So Mal's like, we're getting the hell out of here. And then they find what they believe is a survivor. But the survivor turns into a Reaver basically because he goes crazy. And then he attacks the crew.
Yeah. Starts
cutting
on himself.
And then they get captured by an Alliance cruiser. And there's a whole series of events that happen with that. And we find out that Shepherd Book, who was a preacher on the show, there's more to him than meets the eye. And there keeps being these little, which is again, goes back to this, how they flesh out characters. And we never do find out, even in the film, we never find out. We know he was somehow connected to the Alliance and he was connected to the Alliance at a very high level, but we don't find out what he actually was or did. Now, if you're into comic books, there is a series of comic books that do explain, and it goes through his whole story. And
he's an operative
story.
Yeah.
Basically he was a very high level officer in the Alliance he leaves. But anyway, if you want to find out about his backstory, get the comic book.
Joss wanted a whole lot more backstory for all of the characters, but Joss, like the rest of us, expected to have multiple seasons, unfortunately. So
right.
He didn't get like Jane of all of them, of the whole lot, Jane is the most one dimensional. He's just
pretty much, yeah, just, you know where he stands.
But he got backstory.
They touched on it because they
flew out of gas.
I think they wanted to flesh him out more. But
curb.
Like, if you compare him to like Amos on the Expanse, Amos has so much more going
on. Jamestown, right? Jamestown, of course, is his biggest. His
Jamestown, big, the statue,
you know, which is the statue.
You don't need that costume. They won't recognize you.
They call James. he was like Robin Hood. For those who haven't seen the episode. He was like Robin Hood in this town, and that's where we got Mudder's milk from. That's what they drank, which is they basically mine this mud and turn it into ceramic material for other things. And so it's this very rural, mining type town. And he was there years ago, had robbed the guy that ran the place, and in the process was leaving and the ship was damaged that he was leaving on. And he had to dump the cargo along with his partner We threw out the airlock as he was leaving. And of course, the people that lived there thought that he gave them the money because he let drop this these crates of money. So he became the hero of Canton, which was the name of the town.
Yep.
And they erected a statue and they had songs about him. And of course, he goes back not knowing any of this. And, you know, the best line, I think, was Wash, when he goes, when are we going to get to go to the town where I'm the hero? I want to go to the planet where I'm the hero.
Man wears a hat like that.
And then, yeah, man wears a hat like that. But that's a different episode.
That is a different episode.
The funniest thing was, is that, what's his, the Tam there, the brother, Simon. Simon keeps going, this is what it feels like to go crazy. This must be what it feels like to go crazy. Which again, it goes back to the lines. There's stuffy stuff. It's just great.
The scene with them looking at the statue and all standing there.
And their heads go like this.
Yeah, this is what it feels like to go crazy. I think that was one of the best ones.
This is the most quoted TV show. I think one of the most quoted TV shows. I know around the set tour, I hear you guys saying I'll be in my bunk all the time.
Oh my God, yeah. I'll be in my bunk. Yeah. That's for those of the children earmuffs. So it was something that Jane said when he saw Inara going basically into her quarters with another woman that she was supposed to serve, so to speak, if you want to put it that way. So Jane's just sitting there. He's sitting there. What's he eating? He's eating like an apple or something. He's eating an apple and he's just like drooling and he's like, I'll be in my bunk.
He says it again when she leaves.
Yep.
And I also think Zoe and Wash had a we'll be in our bunk at some point in the course of the series too. I just don't remember where it was.
But the greatest character though they did that wasn't one of the main characters was Christina Hendricks.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
Saffridge.
Saffron. Yeah. Saffron or Yolanda, she was actually in two episodes, so of course we have our Mrs. Reynolds, which is where we meet her the first time.
And then Trash, I think.
And then Trash, right. That's where we find out about the Lasser and we find out her basic backstory of who she really is, which is both those episodes are great episodes.
There's no stinkers.
No, there really aren't. They all are good.
I would say there is one. I would say the train job. I did really? Not like. Yeah, and that's the one they decided to show at the beginning. And to me, it was the weakest episode.
But the fact that Mal immediately dumps the job and says, "No, we're taking the stuff back." It paints his character.
Yeah,
it also
sets them up later for war stories with Niska. So I disagree. I mean, I don't think it's one of their strongest episodes, but I really wouldn't call it bad in any level. I think it does. I think Kent's got a good point. It does establish some character parameters as far as how Mal, that he once he realized that they had stolen drugs that these people really needed, that he's like, I can't do this. I got to give it back. I'm not, you know, I'm a thief, but I'm not a bad guy.
Right.
So
I might have questionable practices, but my morals are good.
Right. He's always going to do the right thing in the end. I like some of the lines, you know, when they're talking about, I think, was it from the film when he's talking about, you know, he's like, you know, we haven't had a job in so long and, you know, and then people got a powerful need to eat, you know, because he's basically, they don't have any money. And it's like, you know, basically he's got to do something. You can't just, you know, be hiding out because they're protecting Simon and River.
Well,
they can't take a lot of legitimate jobs because they don't want to go too far into Alliance space.
He says it on the episode in the bar on Alliance Day. I was on the losing side. I'm not convinced it was the wrong one.
Right. Yep. Right. Exactly. And that's just it. And obviously him and Zoe have quite a history because they served together and that's how they got stuck in Zoe served.
You guys want to do a deep kind of an interesting little mind bend on Firefly, watch Why Firefly Crew Are the Bad Guys by Cracked on YouTube. That just talks about maybe the Alliance were really the good guys and maybe the Firefly crew were really the bad guys.
I can see that instantly. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, look at it from the Alliance's standpoint. They have a society that is for the most part calm and well behaved. If you only look at the core worlds, everybody has a higher standard of living. Everybody's taken care of. And then you got these loudmouth, arrogant
rebels. Yep.
Rebels who think they can do it better than the central state can. The same argument can be applied to Star Wars. If you look at the rebels from the Empire standpoint, they're mass murderers. They blew up a station with 300,000 stormtroopers on it.
Well, you know, Obi-Wan said it. You'll find out in life that most things are from a certain point of view.
Anyway, just for those who want to kind of take that dive, super, super quick, just going back to it being a well-quoted show, Shiny never caught on. We don't say shiny.
Oh, I do.
Do you? I bet you do. Joss picked that word because he was just kind of looking around for a word to mean that. He said, well, shiny, things that are shiny tend to be attractive and exciting and catch our attention, so I'm going to use that as my slang word. I love Jane going, okay, shiny, let's be bad, or whatever he said. But one of the writers was like, oh, hey, great choice of words. That's actually a real old Western phrase or old Western word meaning good. And it was in use back in the 18 whatever. So it was kind of serendipitous, but it was a really great choice of words. So we can all try to incorporate a little shiny into our
Chinese language. Cursing, I am told, is horrible Chinese.
Yeah, that's Chinese what I
people
too.
Will hear them say things and go, what?
Cast admitted,
you know, again, we have American, Western actors, trying to punch out Chinese, and you can't do it in a, when Chinese speak, somebody who spoke Chinese their whole life, and then they try to speak English, they have a heavy accent. The reverse is happening.
They had Chinese advisor on set, and she would give the cast actual cassette tapes. Like old school cassette tapes.
Rosetta Stone.
Of her saying the lines, but she couldn't act. So if it was a curse, it was like, you goddamn whatever. She'd be like really sweetly in Chinese, you goddamn whatever, and then the actors had to be like, okay, how do I say this angry? And it's hard to say it angry because, Chinese has inflection and you can't get the inflection wrong. So if you said it angry with an American affection, it might be actually changing the meaning of what you're saying. So they had a hard time with the Chinese, but they mastered it. But even they got it.
The phraseology, even the rhythm of the talking is very different. And I remember the cast being asked, did you find that hard? And, most of them said, it took sort of one or two episodes. And Fillion's like, he says, I can go back to it like this.
It's a very, what we consider a very, 1880s type way of talking. It's got
that my Western, pretty floral bonnet.
I will end you. Yeah, my. That's what I'm saying. Again, great lines. I mean, there's just, you can't even quote them all because there's just so many. I love the line where, what does that make us? Big damn hero, sir.
Big damn hero,
big damn hero, sir.
So she's always ends everything with the sir, because she feels that she's, even though she's not under his command by military standards anymore, she still looks at him as in that way.
Well, I'm a pretty good man. Stabs him again.
Oh, yeah. Okay. All right. I'm not that great a man. one of the things that hooked me on the show during the train job episode, which I didn't see coming when I first watched it, because of course I didn't know anything about the show because I'm watching the very first episode ever aired. He's talking to the thug outside the Serenity, telling him, go back to Niska. Here's the money. We're just want to part ways. The guy's going, nope, you're dead. You're dead. And he just, I'm sorry. And he kicks the guy, and the guy gets sucked into the engine that's running next to him, and he's gone. And then the next guy goes, yes, it's best for both of us. Yes.
We're good.
And he leaves. But the fact that I just didn't see it coming with him kicking the guy and just him going right into the engine. Like, it was just like you didn't expect that at all. And it was like, I'm like, oh, I'm hooked
that
up.
Was awesome.
Right there. I was like, love this show.
Yep.
Yep. That was awesome.
Actually, Fox had something to that. I don't know. Maybe
when Mal did the nope, we're taking the medicine back. That was what caught me. I think the fact that they were desperate for a job, they were getting them, they got paid or partially, they succeeded, and then they give it back and give the money back, or try to give the money back, because their morals were bigger than
Mal's was. I don't, certainly Jane wouldn't have gave it back.
No, Jane would not have given it back.
So I was, again, you know, the fact that they named him Jane, I think, is also pretty funny. The one episode, I think it's, what's the name of it? When they come across their friend that's dead. And
the one where he gets the hat.
Yeah, that's the one I was going to talk about. So, you know, he finally gets, they're on a space station, they're picking up their mail, and Jane gets a box from his mother. And in the box is this horrible knitted hat. And that's when Wash goes, man wears a hat like that. You know, he's not afraid of anything. I've used that line, I don't know how many times. Between that and from Caddyshack, looks good on you, though.
The hat is the most cosplayed. Like, when you look at Firefly cosplay, there's so many people running around the hat. Where do you even find a hat?
Oh, they
like,
had them, Entertainment
People Earth are making them on Etsy and stuff.
Yeah, you can buy them. Go on Etsy.
People were making them.
It's such a simple thing. It's a knitted hat in orange.
With the long...
People are making them, and they actually have to go almost like the you know, the Star Trek fan films and say, no, stop. Stop. This is, you know...
Speaking of fan film, there is an excellent one out there for Firefly called The Verse. It came out about 5 years ago. If you want to look at it, it's 15
with,
minutes
with long. Joss's blessing, I believe.
Anyway, go on YouTube, just put in Firefly fan film. It'll come up since we're kind of a fan film group.
Because it was for charity, right?
You know, I don't know the back. I haven't watched it since it came out.
It was with Joss's. I'm almost certain. It's the only one ever made. It was with Joss's blessing. They debuted it at one of the Comic Cons, whatever, but it was for charity.
It's really well done. High production value. Probably the closest thing I've seen to a non-Firefly characters just takes place in the same verse. I like that term, the verse. Yep.
The verse,
Speaking of fan films, Nathan Fillion did an Uncharted. You know, people that are familiar with the PlayStation game Uncharted, which is like a Tomb Raider, Lara Croft kind of thing, but it's a guy. Excellent series of games. You haven't played him, but he did one because he looks a lot like the main character of this game, and he did one for a live action Uncharted. It's again only like 15 minutes long, but it's so excellent. And you're like, of course, he's like the perfect person to play Nathan Drake, who is the character. Anyway, I just want to throw that out since we're talking about fan films, and again, worth watching if you like. A, if you like Uncharted, and B, if you like Nathan Fillion. He's just great in everything he does. I can't say I've seen anything that he's really bad in. Of course, he was the original Private Ryan. People don't quite remember that. He was the first one they found that thought his 8-year-old brother had been killed in the war, when they said, your brother's dead. He's in elementary school. If you remember Saving Private Ryan?
No. Yeah.
Am I like people getting glassy?
No, no, yeah.
He was the first... Nathan Fillion was the first Private Ryan
tracked down.
The wrong one.
Year was that? Wow.
Late 90s. So it was before this. Late 90s. He was young. Yeah, the first thing I ever saw. Of course, I didn't realize until later that was him. But
He was also in Buffy.
Yep.
Never was a big Buffy fan, but really my first introduction to Joss was Firefly.
Watch Dollhouse?
No, that's really just not my thing. I'm sure they're fine shows, but I don't watch a lot of the supernatural type stuff.
Oh, Dollhouse is not supernatural at all.
I don't even know what that is. So, I do know he did Buffy, and he did was it?
He's done a million things.
He did Avengers, of course. Which is why he probably never would go back to doing Firefly, because he's doing huge Marvel.
He ends up getting called in on projects to fix them too.
Yeah.
He salvaged as much as he could of Alien 3.
Yeah. Buffy, Angel, Firefly. And then
Angel. That was the other one I was thinking of.
Yeah.
Alien Cabin Resurrection. In the Woods, and then a whole bunch of Marvel.
Oh, Cabin in the Woods was terrific.
He's an excellent writer. He can flesh out a story. He has, the guy's talented. There's no
Agents of Shield. I did enjoy that.
The master of the dialogue.
Snappy, snarky dialogue. Yes.
I mean, the whole thing about, putting the Hulk on a submarine. Well, that's not a smart idea. Oh no, it's not a submarine.
Still my favorite, if we're going to talk Avengers for a minute, my favorite was on the first Avengers movie is when the Hulk grabs Loki and just slams him back and forth like 15 times. Yep. I thought that was, that made me laugh out loud so hard because it was just so class. I mean, I don't know why.
The expression on his face when he gets his leg grabbed, he goes, and then whap, 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 whap.
That and then just the poom.
And I want to think, that was Joss that said, we got to do this. You know, this is what the Hulk would just like slam him around like he was a rag doll.
Does anybody
who is watching have any questions for us?
They've been chatting right along. Yeah,
they've been chatting. They always do that because, you know, we're just not.
We haven't. We haven't really checked in on them too much.
I know. I keep trying to. And then.
Sue was mad that we gave out spoilers because Roy hadn't seen it yet. But
well, you know what? Cool. It's been around for 20 something years. Bruce has got a point. Almost 20 years.
Yep.
Watch it, people.
It's like spoiling Princess Bride.
Right. Yeah.
At this point, you can't do it.
And Roy does.
You knew you were going to do it, so you had plenty of time to watch it. You could have binged it. You can binge it in a weekend, no problem.
Yeah. Oh, you can shotgun it real quick. Yeah,
you can shotgun it because you will. Once you start watching it.
Robert, hey, Damien, Rob. Morrow, haven't seen you for a while. Yeah. Hello, hello, hello.
Yeah. Hi, Rob. So,
he's commenting on Thor and Loki or, Hulk and Loki.
Oh yeah, well there was a lot of, and you know, that's in those moments,
they went for the laugh, and I get that,
the laugh, and why not?
You needed that moment though. I mean,
yeah, I mean, you can't, there was so much seriousness in some of those movies that you kind of needed that. And even, and again, in Firefly we have that, you know, we have that during the in Serenity we have the big battle, the fight scene between the operative and Nathan, and Nathan's getting his, you know, he's getting his ass kicked literally. I mean these guys just wailing on him. And finally, of course, Mal gets the upper hand, and you know, there's a whole slew of you know, what does he say? Well, the operative's thing is, you know what your sin is, and he's like, you know, I'm a fan of a whole bunch.
I'm pretty fond of rap right now.
That was the operative thing. You know what your sin is, and why you're gonna die, and he's like, I don't know, I'm a fan of a bunch.
and they paid off the thing at the beginning where he paralyzes the scientist and makes him fall on his sword.
Right.
He goes to paralyze Mal, and Mal's like, nope, had that shot up in the war. That's not even there anymore.
That nerve cluster got moved. Yeah. Had to have it moved or something, he said. So it's not there. And that's the only way he got the upper hand.
Right.
And of course, he makes the operative watch the video, or he sees that what, and he ultimately ends up flipping sides and agreeing with Mal that this needs to get out. You can't just ignore.
Yeah.
In other words, you can't be a blind soldier and just do what you're told. These people are evil, basically, that are running the lines. They are evil.
Well, of course.
And we didn't even talk about, they never fleshed out the whole, the two guys, the two hands, you know, 2x2 hands of blue.
There were a lot of stuff teased that never got paid off.
Yeah, we never find out. There's these characters that are like assassins or something, and they're twins.
Operative is the general term.
Yeah, they're twins. They don't talk much. They wear blue rubber gloves all the time.
Yeah.
They got that sound thing
somehow by their, they must like rupture their brain because they start bleeding out their noses and die.
Because I think there was a callback to that on Castle because he was putting on the gloves. The
blue gloves, yeah. Well, it's just that the River says, you know, 2x2 hands of blue, and she's like in her crazy ramblings. And then we see why, because she sees...
Robert, you haven't watched Firefly?
Rob, really, Robert? I don't know you. I don't know
dude.
You.
Dude, I actually think this one's up your alley.
I can't. It just kind of wrapped me up about people that are Star Trek fans and all these fans, and they've never watched.
Well, it's the opposite of Star Trek. We talked about that with Dr. Phil a little bit. It's the opposite of Star Trek. Where Star Trek, everyone was shiny. Yeah. Everyone was like professional and in uniform, and we are very... This was the opposite. But
it's more like we're traveling with Han Solo than we are, you know.
Yeah, like hanging out with Han Solo, hanging out with a whole slew of Han Solos of various
tight pants,
and then maybe a Lando
tight pants.
Here's the question:
like hanging out with Han and Lando and Captain tight pants. Yeah.
Here's the question for people: 2 years later, BSG was rebooted. where it got into the dirty and stuff like that.
The gritty. Yeah.
Do you think that Firefly would have done better if it had been 2 years later and BSG had already started and no. helped all towards that?
I don't know, but you're absolutely right.
I don't know. I mean, I don't really. To me, they're not that similar.
Well, no, but he's talking about gritty and realistic.
Whether that genre would have
pioneered the rect focus. It pioneered the like offset, off frame, off centered frame. It pioneered the zoom jump, the jumping zoom, whatever the hell it was. It pioneered all that crap that we then saw tons of on BSG. The flares. Firefly had flares that we now mock JJ endlessly for.
Yeah, but it wasn't, they didn't overdo it like JJ did.
No.
JJ just like, it was like,
there wasn't a guy off camera with a flashlight.
Then, yeah. Right. And at the time, and then back then I didn't realize, oh, Firefly did this and now Battlestar is doing it. I just thought, wow, look at Battlestar. It's so cool.
Yeah, Battlestar had a lot of other things that
Bruce kind of has a point. Yeah.
Well, I mean, it's arguable. I mean, I don't know. I think what would have made it probably would have done better had it had a better time slot.
Mm-hmm.
Probably on a better network that wasn't, maybe if Sci-Fi had just picked it up from the get-go.
Yeah.
Yeah. Fox
similar to like, you know, you look at like, would Farscape have been financially successful if it was on CBS?
No.
Probably not. No. You know, but because it was on Sci-Fi point. Where you have a, you know, the people are looking to that and they can, that's their genre. So they're not going to cancel a show because, although,
that is like
they do have a bad running, track record of canceling stuff.
The other
that
side
is an ongoing thing where shows say the network didn't know or the studio didn't know what it had.
Yeah, I think this was definitely a case of that for Firefly. They were just like, we don't know what this is and we don't know how to market it.
The other side of it, though, is that Buffy and Angel were still running. So the other question becomes, you know, did Joss have enough time to really fight the network? Did he put the
right? Effort? He was running.
You have to ask shows. Him that.
Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah, there that's is great,
and I don't
great
know if it's available. Point. There is a 10-year anniversary show that they did. Let me see if I can find it. On that they did.
Robert, you yeah, sorry.
There it is.
I saw that too, Mary Beth.
It's on. So it's only the only others.
Mary Beth's gone. Bye bye. What have you got left, Egon?
I'm sorry. Kids and I are reacting. Robert's like, I should probably watch Battlestar.
It was really good that they did. I think at one of the Comic Cons. I think you're right, Kent. It was like in a studio though setting. It wasn't just like a
search
panel.
On YouTube. Like,
yeah,
it was like a retrospective. Have, maybe search for retrospective.
I see fire a panel, and then
there was one called Big Damn Heroes.
There is one, but it's only the clip is only an hour, a minute and a half. So unless that's an hour 30.
Yeah, no. There was a Firefly cast roundtable on the Blu-ray, and I forget what year that was from.
That might be it.
Maybe Firefly, the making of, that was a half an hour long, and we had a lot of behind them.
This was like them all sitting around a table, like in a limbo set. Yeah. It was like a dark. I think it's on there. It's on the Blu-ray.
Yep.
Yeah, it's worth watching. It's really good. There's a lot. They give a lot of insight to stuff that, you know, happened on the show and what they were feeling when they got canceled. And, you know, they really enjoyed that cast. They weren't like, there was no, to my knowledge, there was no infighting. There was none of this, oh, so-and-so's getting the limelight, you know.
They really were a lot closer person, to the family.
But they really all enjoyed each other's company. And I think that's probably why it works, because
it shows,
it just shows that they just meshed so well. I know I like bubble about this show when I talk about it, because it's just so dear to my heart. I love it so much.
Brings right back to the cast, and boy, did they do a good job in getting the cast together. Most of them had done nothing before this.
No, almost just essentially unheard of. I mean, Nathan obviously had a few things.
And, Ron Glass was the big gun.
Ron Glass was the big gun.
No, it's funny. When I saw him in the show, I'm like, Barty Miller, immediately. I read it.
Yep.
That's the guy with Barty Miller.
At first,
I thought WKRP, and then I went, no, that's not him.
No, you're thinking of Venus Flytrap.
Yeah.
Venus Flytrap. Summer Glau admitted everything was for, it was her first table read, her first, not audition, but it was her first table read.
She was only like 16, I think, like that.
Yeah. She and Jewel were 2021 that around then.
Yeah. So, yeah, I mean, and she looks, you know, it's funny because you see her in the Terminator and she looks different. I mean, it's still her, but doesn't she, I guess obviously she doesn't have that teenage young, maybe it's just the way they made her up in the show, but she looks so much more mature in other things that she's done. You know, it doesn't look like River.
He's my nemesis, please. Thank you.
One of my favorite items I have that's in the kitchen is a coffee mug that has a silhouette of River from the film where she's holding the two axes. The
axe and the sword.
Yeah. And it just says, don't make me get all River on you.
Yeah.
That's one of my favorite coffee mugs.
I'd like to see again where the 100-pound girl knocks you out.
That never gets old.
We mentioned KRP, so Dennis Chevalier remembered the great turkey drop.
Because turkey drop's coming up. I post that every year.
It's coming.
One of the funniest moments on television.
Bellquist, if you are still out there, can you remind me, is this Friday the Star Wars show? Because I am really excited for the Star Wars show. It's the anniversary, so he's going to let us all... Oh, sorry, the Star Trek.
Yeah, bad. I was going to say, we did Star Wars already.
I know, I went off the rails for a second there. We can all join in and sort of chime in and say our own fond memories of Star Trek, the original
series. Sunday, right?
Is that Sunday? Rory, remind me, what's Friday? I have a memory.
Well, the 6th is the actual day.
But it's Capricorn 1 on Friday, I think.
Oh, Capricorn 1. Okay, I knew it was another good one. Yep, Roy has Capricorn 1 on Friday with his partner, Ross. And then on Sunday, we can all join in and talk about Star Trek, the original series, which is all near and dear to our hearts.
Yeah.
Wait, there was a show called Star Trek?
What? Show? What?
What? Next, you're going to tell me that William Shatner was in it or something.
Something like that.
T.J. Hooker? No, he wasn't in anything before T.J.
Hooker.
He started with T.J.
So, that man could cling to a hood better than anybody.
So since we're talking about upcoming next week, we have a special guest, and I'm going to put this up. We are going to talk about the 1984.
Oh, Enemy Mine.
Enemy Mine, and our special is Dayton Ward. And the reason we're bringing Dayton in is because we believe there is a lot of parallels with this and the help me out with the name of the episode, TNG the episode.
Darmok.
Mm-hmm. Darmok,
and possibly the arena. You could compare it to the arena.
A little bit. I think this is also has a lot of feel Robinson Crusoe on Mars.
Yeah,
a lot of that feel to this film as well. Certainly in a modern, but this is excellent film, and probably Louis Gossett Jr. should have got an Academy Award.
Should have, yes, definitely.
So please join us, and we're gonna have Dayton here, and of course Dayton has just written a new Star Trek book, which I'm almost done with Agents of Influence.
I will probably finish it
before next week. So it's very good. All of Dayton's books are great. I've read a lot of them. He is very good especially when it comes to TOS stuff.
Hey, Kent, do you remember getting all this sort of razzmatazz when they announced us? You know, there was a special guest star and special...
Not a word of it. Nope.
No.
That's because
ahead and write a bunch of Star Trek novels that are really great. Or, work on a TV show that you know, we all love, and we'll give you the fanfare. Otherwise, you're just much like the rest of us.
Excuse me. I did work on a TV show that we all know and love. It's called Star Trek New Voyages.
Okay. We all worked on that.
Exactly.
Except Bruce.
Bruce was there for like one of the ending shoots, I think.
No, he weren't. He was a Trek Conoroga guy.
Wasn't he there for Torment of Destiny?
Bruce, were you there for something?
No.
I came in and Trek Conoroga 2.
Man, see how my memory's... My memory's
all mushy. It's all mushy. It all runs together.
Having me around like it's been forever.
What else could we say about this show as we're actually past the 8 o'clock hour? I hate to keep people late because I like to try to end as close to on time as we can. But
I think you said it right. If you haven't seen it, it's a binge-worthy show.
It holds up well.
Episodes. Watch it on a weekend. It is well worth it, especially if you see the episodes in order.
And it's fun and it's action and it won't. Not in order.
On the DVDs, they are in the chronological order that they were intended to.
Right.
Not what Fox did. And I think I've watched it that way since, and I think it's the way to, it's, yeah, that's where you want to do it.
So what was your favorite episode, Rizzo, if you had to say one?
Wow.
That's hard.
Trash, maybe. Because I love the way it starts with him naked on the dumpster, and
right.
and then we flash back of how he ends up there. It's so hard to say I have a favorite one. You know, Out of Gas, of course, is such a good episode because we learn so much about the characters. Everyone.
Yeah.
But I, you know, and up there, see, I got this, but of course, and again, Objects in Space, you know, with Jubal Earth, the very last one is yep. got to be another one of my favorite ones.
So, what about you, Mary Beth?
I liked Armis Reynolds. That to me was
great. Armis Reynolds. Yeah, I'm with both the guys. They're all good. I can't pinpoint. And, you know, I actually have stronger memories of Serenity. I need to maybe go back and rewatch the series.
You know what? Here's, and I know there's only like 13, 14 episodes, but the thing with it is, like any other series, there's like, oh yeah, this one I'm not that great. I mean, even Star Trek. Right. I love Star Trek, but you know, every once in a while, it's like, oh, there's this episode. Yeah, it's not so great. I might not watch it. There is none that I will say that to Serenity.
Yeah.
You know, to Roy's Firefly. Right. There's none that I say, ago, I'm not going to watch this because I don't like this episode.
4 years ago, we were all down in New York City for Mission New York.
Yep. Yeah, those are crazy. Popping up in my feed. Yeah. That's, it's hard to believe that was 4 years
ago already. Yeah, I think that was 4 years.
What was your favorite, Mr. Playfair?
No, Armis Reynolds. Yeah.
And Ken.
I love the question.
I'm gonna say Out of Gas. I really, really like the depth.
Ken agrees with you.
Yeah.
And the fact that the characters that we see already settled into their roles had to find that role. Wash wasn't the hotshot pilot until he fell in love with Serenity and started flying her around. He may have been a good pilot, but when he got into Serenity, it clicked. And Kaylee, master mechanic who has no formal training, ended up on Serenity because she was making out with the prior engineer, and right. Mal throws him right off the boat. Those kind of little touches, just they call each of the characters out really strongly, and Out of Gas is definitely my favorite.
Yeah. Well, that goes back to the line at the end of Serenity when he's talking to
she River.
He's like, you know, you don't take a boat in the air that you don't love, you know, that kind of thing. So it's all about love is what keeps her afloat.
And don't fly in anything with a Capucin 16 engine. They fall right out of the sky.
Yeah, that was in Shindig.
Yep, that was Shindig.
No. I take that back. No, that was in Out of Gas. That was in Out of Gas. She was saying that. Just
first came on board.
She was saying that to Shepherd Book, right.
Yep.
Oh, when they were, no. She was talking to River and Simon because they were getting off.
All right.
And she's like, don't listen to the barkers, talk to the captain, and don't get in a ship and with the captain, right. They fall right out of the sky.
Yep.
You're right.
Gotta go back and watch it again, darn it.
Gotta watch it again. I'm gonna sit this week and watch it.
We need to host a watch party.
I wish you could do that, but I'm already going to get pinned when I put this on YouTube with the
opening.
That's in Serenity when River and Simon are leaving the ship.
Yeah.
I knew it was. Yeah. There you go. All right, guys. Well, thanks for joining us. I think that pretty much wraps it up. I could talk about Serenity and Firefly all night.
Hours more.
Maybe we'll do another show on it. Who knows? Maybe we'll do one just Serenity. Who knows? If you guys want to, let us know in the comments.
Absolutely.
But we'll see you next week with Dayton, and we're going to do Enemy Mine, and that should do it. So,
peace and long life.
Good night, guys.